let me run you through what we are doing and why we are organizing this series of webinar. We started this initiative for stroke survivors, and because stroke has become a public health issue over the years, and now it has slowly taken a shape of a disease, or I will say a cause, which is now getting in directly into our families. One in four people you know may suffer from a stroke during their lifetime. So it's no longer something which is foreign, alien, or restricted to either an urban area or a rural area. So thus we got a feedback from different patients who have undergone stroke that a series of capacity building initiatives should be started, whereby they would be provided correct information about what is stroke, why do people get stroke, where to go when they have stroke, whom to approach, what is a stroke ready hospital, and all. So we have formally started a initiative for stroke survivors, and we have formed an organization called Stroke Support Alliance. It's basically an alliance consisting of different stroke survivor groups, stroke survivors, their caregivers, their care providers, that is stroke specialists, those who provide service health care providers, those who provide services to these health survivors from different parts of the country. And that's what we intend to do. We intend to bring all these people who have had this lived experience of either suffering from a stroke or knowing somebody who has undergone stroke, and thus they know the pain and the disruption which is caused in their overall family when stroke occurs. And for this reason, we have started this initiative in four cities of India to start off with: Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai, and Hyderabad. And then we will be slowly moving on to the rest of the country. The key reason for this is to make people aware that this is a issue which needs to be dealt with on a priority basis, and where they should go if they happen to have stroke, the kind of services which are available out there overall, either in the public sector or the private sector, and what kind of rehabilitative services they should avail of. So we, I believe Dr. Vijay has joined us. So let me start out by introducing Dr. Professor Vijay. Dr. Vijay is a rehabilitation expert. He has done his PG in physiotherapy. He is an expert in neuro rehabilitation, non-invasive brain stimulation, and rehabilitation. He has over the years been trained and be associated with different hospitals throughout India, ranging from Medanta in Gurgaon, Kokilaben Hospital in Mumbai, and also Hyderabad, where he is presently situated, Care Hospital. He has he has written many research papers, and he got Dr. Sancheti Award for being the best in rehabilitative professional in the year 2020. And his research paper on rehabilitation mapping and planning has been appreciated by all. So he is our expert, rehabilitation expert for this webinar. I welcome him for this webinar. And my second speaker is Mr. Arjun. He will share his lived experience as a stroke survivor and how rapidly he has overcome this issue of stroke which he has faced, and is rapidly turning into a stroke advocate. So without wasting any further time, I would like to call in my first speaker, Doctor, to you.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, doctor, we can hear you.
Yeah, sorry. So thank you so much, Mr. Arindam, sir, and thank you so much, Tamannaji, for coordinating this webinar. So I'm so happy that to be part of this discussion. And then now can I share the screen? Can I add my presentation?
Yes, yes, sir, sure.
Yeah, I think you have to give me permission for sharing the screen.
Yes, sir, sure.
Yeah.
So you can share now.
You can see my screen, presentation screen.
Yes, sir, it started sharing.
But you can see my screen, madam.
No, sir, actually I think you have to share the whole screen with the desktop.
I've done it actually. I think I can see that it is getting shared. Let me know if it is not getting shared.
No, sir. I think you can just start over again, sir. So that I think.
Sure. I'll do it.
Yes, yes, sir.
Now, ma'am.
Yes, yes, sir. It has started. Huh?
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for the opportunity again. So I was asked to start. I was asked to share my experiences in stroke rehabilitation. So I'm in this stroke rehabilitation area for last 12 to 13 years as a clinician practicing physiotherapist, as well as I also do research, both publications. I publish papers, but as well as I also innovated few devices which will measure muscle strength and range of motion with my other IIT friends. When I talk about stroke and stroke rehabilitation, I call it as a journey. It is not just like any other disease. It is something like that. The recovery happens over the time, and recovery happens over the years. That's the reason I call it as a journey and not a one-stop stop. So, and it's a teamwork. It's not one person's job. So I know that you who are all participating in this discussion, at least they know what is stroke and then how it happens and all. But still, before I proceed to this, the next discussion, I just wanted to set the context by giving a little insight of stroke so that the context is set at first. So stroke happens when a blood stops flowing to any part of your brain, damaging the brain cells. It's as simple as definition of that. And then I just wanted to carry this as a story. So when there is a stroke happens to a person, so this is what has been will be noticed. That is, there'll be a face drooping and there'll be arm weakness, there'll be speech difficulty. That's when we need to call for emergency. Now on the screen, you're seeing the different arteries. Don't get confused. I just wanted to show you the number of arteries in our brain. In those, significantly, you can see this particular artery, which is having a bigger diameter. And then this is giving a lot of branches, which is called middle cerebellar artery, which is going to supply a large portion of the brain. Most of the blood supply to the brain is supplied by middle cerebral artery. Those are frequent strokes happens to this particular artery. And then I just wanted to show a glimpse of what types of stroke. Ischemic stroke, that is because of some clot or occlusion, and hemorrhagic stroke because of some arterial damage, you can see. So ischemic stroke happens because of clot, you know, because of atherosclerosis, fat depositions, because of obstruction in the artery, in the brain. Of course, hemorrhagic strokes because of uncontrolled hypertension, because of the artery damage, the blood vessel damage, blood leaks outside, that is called hemorrhagic stroke. So it is because of occlusion, that is obstruction in the artery. This is because of damage of the artery. So these are the two basic, there are many other types, but these are two basic. And then you can see the other picture, the same context I'm setting there. You can see the blood clots here, and you can see fatty plaque here. That is again a clot which is obstructing the middle. And you can see the thrombus over the sides of the wall of the artery. Even in these situations, you can see ischemic strokes. Even in these situations, you can see ischemic strokes. This is called thrombus, this is called embolus. And this situation where you have a leak of blood, bleeding of the blood from the artery, that is called hemorrhage. And each lobe of the brain is having a lot of functions. Each area of the brain have different functions. So pertaining to the area of stroke, particularly the damage will happen. For example, if the stroke is hemorrhagic and this is in moment area, the moment along with other functions, moment also may get affected largely. If there is, and this area is called frontal region. If the stroke is happening in frontal zone, these functions called attention, planning, decision making, all these are going to get affected. So stroke is different from each person. It is specific to type of stroke, and then it is specific to type of stroke as well as the length of time that is taken to reach to the medical center, or the length of time that is taken to start the treatment. Just this is for just an example where I wanted to give a cite in statement where how much blood supply it is actively required for the brain to function. It is more than 20 ml per minute. If it is less than 10 ml, it leads to cellular death, that is cell death. So at this stage, what happens? The sodium and potassium, that are key elements of the cell functioning, will get affected. So whenever there is lesser availability of blood to the brain, these channels, sodium and potassium, frequently, if this can be related to most of the stroke patients where they will have less of sodium, less of potassium. So checking sodium and potassium in stroke patients, even after they recover, it is so important because availability of sodium and potassium is very important for brain functioning. So the area of stroke is called ischemic penumbra. So whenever there is stroke, as I said, if you reach the medical help, if you seek medical help, or if you can attend to a hospital, within 6 hours of time, the intensity of stroke will be less. So usually when there is an admission with the stroke in hospitals, they look for insulin, that is what is the level of glucose, and then they try to correct the glucose, and immediately they'll start neuroprotective treatment with antiplatelet drugs, and they try to control the BP. If there is a hemorrhage, the line of treatment is different. If it is a ischemic stroke, the line of treatment is different. So larger the time, the more the damage. That is what I want to tell you. So here you can see, this is a glimpse of type of, I just wanted to give a little insight how much cell damage, or what is the nature of cell damage that is going to happen when there is a stroke. Think this is a cell in the brain, and this is called ischemic penumbra and this is called ischemic core. If there is a stroke in a cell, this ischemic penumbra can get blood supply back if the treatment is happening before 6 hours. This is called ischemic core, where the damage, if permanent, permanently the blood supply to this particular area will be less. So larger this black dot, larger the irreversible change. For example, this area of cell, this area of brain is larger after stroke. That means the reversibility is good. The brain cells can be reversed, that because of restoration of blood supply. If black area is more, the irreversibility is more. And then once the stroke has happened, medical rescue will, once the person reaches the hospital, medical treatment will start, and the treatment will happen according to the type of strokes. So immediately, there is a phenomenon called neuroplasticity, by which neural cells, the brain cells, will start taking its new functioning by synaptic connections, by latent pathways, like the neurons are going to, new neurons are going to start developing, new pathways, new pathways are going to start generating. Yeah, so early rehabilitation saves the penumbra. So early the rehabilitation, greater the penumbra. This is all, So this is all about little insight about stroke and how a clinical picture happens in a person internally when there is a stroke. So I think most of you know till this slide where how it happens and what happens and then what. So, but I really thought of talking about every detail of neurorehabilitation, but what I thought is, let me discuss core of stroke patient problems. So most of about 90, you can see I have structured four components here. One is spasticity, because of spasticity, a lot of people will have issues in hand control as well as walking. And there is a problem with speech, and there will be a problem to return to work. So these are the primary problems which I was encountering last 10 to 12 years. There are a lot of other problems, but major problems are this, that is hand and walking balance, speech, and return to work. So I wanted to emphasize more on this actually. So you can see this. These are the different types of presentations that you're seeing here. There are different kind varieties of spasticity that exist in hand, depending on the stroke and depending on the rehabilitation, initial rehabilitation the person undergoes. So there may be this presentation, which is called flexed elbow presentation. There will be wrist bend presentation, pronated forearm presentation. This is called clenched fist presentation. And you can see thumb in palm presentation. There are different types of spasticity or hand presentation you can see. So I just wanted to throw some light how internally a muscle will be there when there is a hand spasticity or a muscle spasticity. You can see here, this is a normal structure inside the muscle. You can see the thinness of the structures inside. When there is a muscle stiffness, you can see the thickness. And then when there is a fibrosis or spasticity, think this is spastic muscle and this is called fibrous muscle. The difference is spastic muscle will have still the amount of contraction will be little preserved. When the spastic muscle is underused, undertreated, then disused, then the muscle become fibrosed. Means there, this tissue is no more can be contracted, no more can be functioned. So usually when there is stroke, when we can, if someone is here, that can be reversed to normal structure. If it goes to fibrosis, it is almost impossible to reverse to normal structure. So we need to understand the variety of muscle that a spastic hand has. So there are different managements, of course, physiotherapy, and then other medical management This is there are baclofen medication, there is baclofen pumps, there is botulinum toxin injections, and there are some stem cell therapy. As a physiotherapist, I won't be having much understanding about it, but with little experience what I've got, patients usually start with baclofen tablets, and then they try botulinum toxin injections, and they also try baclofen pumps. These days, people are proposing stem cell therapies for spasticity management, particularly upper limb. So in rehabilitation, in rehabilitation's area, there are few key management approaches which have been recent in advance. So I would like to discuss in them few of them. So what the experience which I've got, what I feel is, for hand rehabilitation, particularly to avoid spastic hands, which I've showed you now. Starting with shoulder blade. Shoulder blade is something like this. You can see shoulder blade is called scapula. Hand rehabilitation or spasticity management should always start from scapula. That is this shoulder blade. Lot of therapists and lot of people start moving their fingers first. So whenever there is a hand rehabilitation program, it should start from scapula, allowing scapula to activate first, along with other muscles. Shoulder control only gives good range, and shoulder control only will give established stability in hand function. So typically therapist or patient should look at scapular function first, and later move to elbow, and later move to wrist. So the key element is shoulder blade in hand rehabilitation, particularly if there is a spastic hand. You can see different kinds of exercises which I have projected here. And then this is coming from scapula, shoulder blade training is one point of it. And there is, and the other management for spastic hand is stretching and maintaining the length. You must have seen your physiotherapist must be stretching you first before they do an exercise. The key component to the key element that the physiotherapist consider to stretch the muscles, spastic hand, the very reason is short-term muscles, unused muscles are more prone to spasticity, and that leads to fibrosis. So whenever the muscle length is not optimally maintained, when the muscle length is not maintained well, then the muscle going into fibrosis, the chances are more. So stretching the muscle, maintaining the muscle in length is so important and key element. And these are few stretching exercises for the reference I've given. I can share you later. There are many other. So there are few to maintain the length and maintain the position. There are few devices which have now been available. One of these are the flexible braces and splints, where by keeping the muscle in good length, wrist or arm in the good length, you can also actually move the wrist. So this is one update, and that is all about rehabilitation in keeping the spastic muscle in length, approaching shoulder blade first. This is so key in maintaining the shoulder function and hand function. And then coming to botulinum toxin injections. So botulinum toxin injection, as I said, medically people can talk even more better than me, but with my little experience, what I've got is it'll inhibit a substance called acetylcholine, availability of acetylcholine to muscle. So that is how it functions. And then by taking botulinum injections, people think that this is a cure. It is not like that. If you take botulinum toxin injection to a muscle which is fibrosed already, the recovery is not possible. If the muscle is at this stage, probably if you take baclofen injections, when it followed by good amount of rehabilitation, then only the results are very good. Taking baclofen toxin injections or botulinum toxin injections or baclofen tablets alone is not going to produce anything. Combining with good amount of intense rehabilitation, the results are more better and oriented. Yeah, there are different amounts of varieties of baclofen administration, which is transdermal, there is oral, there is intrathecal. So intrathecal pumps are something like this. There'll be a pump which is loaded with baclofen medication. It will be inserted surgically into the spinal cord. Graded doses of baclofen is being released. So this is a surgical procedure which is used in severe spasticities. So this is a ladder for management of spasticity in hand. First, you can see stretching, splinting and positioning and oral medication. Then we can try electrical stimulation and Botox injections. And then if it is not working, then by intrathecal baclofen pumps and then goes to tendon transfer surgeries. Better, more early, early the rehab, better the prognosis, better the results. So coming, that is all about hand and hand spasticity management methods that are available presently. So coming to next next issue that is faced by most of the stroke patients is walking walking issues at gait issues and walking balanced issues. So a lot of literature, evidence is saying gait issues comes when you doesn't follow the actual sequence of development. That means when there is no trunk balance, when a person cannot sit actively, independently, if walking training is started, then the chances of faulty walking is more. For example, a person is not able to sit from lying position. If he got promoted with little support or maximum support to walking pattern will be altered, and that walking pattern will be learned by the brain. Faulty walking pattern, and that is continued throughout the life. So establishing trunk balance first, that is sitting balance first, then promoting to standing is so important. You can see different positions of trunk balance training here. So after you achieve trunk balance, then only a stroke patient should be promoted to standing balance training. One should not rush from trunk balance to walking training. Trunk balance training, when you establish good trunk support, independent sitting, then only that person should be promoted to standing balance training. Then only he should be able to promoted to walk. And there is a lot of discussion, a lot of queries when I'm in practice, which leg to keep first, the affected leg or unaffected leg. For example, left side is affected, left side is weak. Can I keep my left leg or first, or can I keep my right leg first? Always remember, you have to keep your affected leg, weak leg first, then the strong leg. That gives lot of support, lot of good gait when you walk. So that is the discussion I want to make today. Now I have concise the discussion to very limited because I want to take more questions. I want to discuss more related to stroke and stroke rehabilitation. So now I'm open to questions.
Thank you, Dr. Vatna. We have a few questions which have come from the participant. One is that how can we recognize that the muscle fiber has fibrosis? Is there any method or test for that?
Yeah. So this say about 2 years before, even I also have a similar question. When I was reading about spasticity and its management, particularly in hand, a lot of people are asking, can I go for botulinum toxin, baclofen pumps and all? There should be good amount of muscle preserved before we go for any of this. So we have done little research on that. There are few equipment which are called EMGs, electromyograms. Basically, we have innovated a machine called FEASY, which is a portable EMG device, which is very affordable, which can be made available to stroke patients through physiotherapist, where we use few electrodes like ECG electrodes. These electrodes are placed on the muscle and we'll ask the patient to move or we'll assist them to move. For example, this EMG electrodes will be able to pick the signals only from the muscle, not from the fibrous tissue. So that is one method. And other method is by undergoing regular ultrasound scannings, There are a few radiologists who experts who can actually differentiate between a fibrous tissue as well as the muscle tissue. So there are two methods where people can go and selectively understand how much muscle is preserved. Because to create a muscle, to create and get trained to a function, to a movement, muscle should be preserved first. Otherwise, we'll be keep stretching the fibrous tissue.
Sir, another question which has been asked is, does this sabo stretch help in developing the flexors of the fingers to open the hand?
No, sir. I just kept the image to have a reference. Sabo stretch, again, it comes to the square again. If the muscle is preserved, if there is no severe spasticity, then sabo stretch, sabo flex or sabo products are going to help. If the spasticity is severe and then the muscle is not preserved, the sabo flex or sabo stretch, whatever it is not going to help. It is just a positioning device, and then it has have a control of moving the hand, moving the wrist. That's all about it. It is not going to do anything to the hand except giving some resting position, some positioning effect. That's it.
Okay, sir. And one thing is, does sleeping on the affected side increases the stiffness?
As of now, there is no active studies here on this sleeping on the affected side. But there are complaints from the patients saying that if they sleep on the affected side, they have pain and they feel a lot of stiffness. What I am understanding with this is because of the weak musculature, because of the weak rotator cuff muscles, when you have weakness in the shoulder, when you lie down on the similar side, which is affected side, there will be a chance of compression of the muscles inside the shoulder socket. And there are possibilities of feeling stiffness and pain. But as such, when someone sleeps on the affected side, there won't be any effects or there won't be any disadvantages. It depends on the individual feedback.
So, what is the duration between having a stroke? When does this entire rehabilitation process started, or when it should start?
So what research evidence is saying, sir, within no time, like for example, a person got admitted in a hospital and got stabilized. As soon as he becomes clinically stable, rehabilitation should start. So as soon as possible, the rehabilitation procedure should start. Because the role of clinical practice, role of doctors will be ending once the patient got stabilized. From then, rehabilitation should start.
Okay, and so after stroke has occurred and to say the complete recovery, so what is the usual time span which takes place if a person has rehabilitative services?
Yes, sir. So this is again a typical question, sir. Everyone, every patient or patient attender asks us before they start rehabilitation. So as I was mentioning before, and during my first slides, depending on type of stroke, type of the intensity of stroke, and then the amount of time that has been taken to reach the hospital. And then there are other factors which will influence the recovery. We cannot really tell concretely this is the length of time that this person would take. But what research is saying, there is some kind of predictability. Predictability means approximation of time this person may get recovered. That time can be like this. If a person immediately after stroke got stabilized, and if he can move his leg apart 10 meters, like 2 to 10 meters, that says he may be recovering within 6 to 8 weeks of time. If the same person can lift his index finger or move his shoulder, affected shoulder, that says he can be recovered in a span of 12 to 16 weeks. This is just an approximation, sir. But there are a lot of variabilities in this type of stroke and area involved, and a lot of other factors come into place. So ideally, they say what research is saying is 6 to 18 weeks, 6 to 16 weeks are the duration where the metabolism of the brain, after stroke will be so good, The results are so good when you are in rehabilitation and when you are subjected to good intensity of rehabilitation before 16 weeks. Because the metabolism is good, the climate in the brain is good, the chance of recovery is good.
Okay. This Aushan, one of the stroke survivors asked that when he lies down on his back and tries to do a wrestler's bridge, his fingers of affected hand stretch open. Does this mean the muscles of the fingers are in good order?
No, that have to be examined, sir. We cannot say why it is reflex. Is it happening through a reflex scenario or why because of the pressure that he is... because of exertion of fragility is happening, that we need to examine, sir. I can examine independently or a video call and I can tell about it.
Okay. So that can be done only by examination. So
yes.
Another question which was asked is, sir, how to know whether Botox should be actually given to a stroke patient and whom to reach out for that?
Yeah, so I'll share my experience here with this Botox injections. Usually, my known neurologist who was dealing my patients, what he says is, for example, there is someone who got severe spasticity, baclofen medication is not getting effect, is not effective to relieve his tone. That is, basically, Botox is given to reduce the tone and give a try of creating good movement. So first they'll give a test dose, sir, to selected muscles which are spastic. We do some study called SD curve test, where we see the contractibility of the muscle. We'll see how much muscle is getting contracted. And then we map that muscles to the neurologist, sir. These muscles are having contraction. These muscles can be taken into consideration after your examination, whether you can go with Botox or not. So neurologist selectively chooses them, who chooses the muscles who are having contraction. They give Botox dose depending on the patient to patient. So it usually takes some time to see the results. And over the time, if the results are good, there is good amount of tone reduction after initial test dose, then actual dose can be planned. That is what we are practicing at present. The results are varied, sir. Few patients are having good results, few patients are not. If you ask me who are having good results, who are actually having good amount of wrist extension, means who are able to grasp anything and release a little. If there is no release at all, then Botox is also not helping. This is just I'm telling out of my experience.
Another question which has been asked is, sir, does music therapy help in stroke recovery?
Yeah, definitely. So this is a good add-on, sir. These days, we are also trying this. Definitely, music therapy is helping, but there is lot to explore in that area. There are subject matter experts. There are few in Mumbai, there are few in Chennai who are doing these studies and they're producing good amount of results. Music therapy helps in different ways, relaxing the mood, creating a good thought process, creating good environment to do exercises. But there is a lot of research which is happening to understand how this music therapy is trying to, you know, produce good amount of neural connections in the brain, good amount of results and outcomes. A lot of research should happen, but as of now, definitely music therapy is helpful. But how much and for what, and all is still in research.
So any opinion on say alternative medicine or therapies for stroke rehabilitation?
In specific, sir, if you can tell me.
I know people say that maybe some alternative medicines do help. So based on your years of experience.
Yes, sir. There are patients who come back to me and say after taking country medicines and alternative therapies, few have the symptoms are worsened, few have improved, sir. What I feel is if someone is someone is recovering with regular rehabilitation, for people take it like this is taking too long, let me try alternative medicine for fast recovery. In such situations, I don't think so. Reasonably, you will achieve good results because already you are seeing some results. Only because of the slowness of the results, you should not approach. If there are no results, if there is absolutely zero with a lot of effort, then you may consider a good subject matter effort, subject matter expert in terms of alternative medicine. But depends on the practitioner, sir. Who is doing it and how far he is good at this. This is so important.
Sir, what about people say acupuncture or acupressure? Does it work? What has been your experience?
Acupuncture, so to a certain extent, it is helping, sir. Acupressure is not going to help.
Okay. I will stop the set of questions at present, because that you can always send us those queries, and Dr. Vijay will definitely help us with the queries you have been raising. We'll cater to that. Thank you, Dr. Vijay. Now I will like to welcome Mr. Arjun, who has been with us patiently waiting for his session to come to share his story as a stroke survivor. So, Arjun, it's all over to you. Hello, Arjun, you are muted.
I'll just try to connect with him. Hi, Arjun.
Hi, madam.
Can you please unmute yourself?
Good evening.
Yeah. Now we can hear you.
Yeah, Arjun, you can come online. Yeah, please.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Welcome.
Hi,
welcome.
Thanks for the opportunity.
Yeah. Good evening. Arjun, I would like you to share your story as to how you had suffered this stroke, from where you could access the services, and the extent of your recovery and your path, the entire journey, so that other stroke survivors can benefit from your experience.
Okay, actually, I have to say that my stroke has happened due to the missed dosage of blood thinner, which was prescribed for me. To be taken by lifelong after my valve replacement surgery had in the year 2014. Actually, in the 2014 I had a valve replacement surgery in Apollo Chennai Apollo Hospital. At that time they have prescribed me a blood thinner, okay, which is because as the valve is a prosthetic valve or metal valve does not have the functioning of a blood thinning, okay, so it should be functioned by the blood thinner, blood to be filtered in the blood with end before entering the heart, okay. And actually in the year 2017 August 13, okay, this was the my stroke date, okay. It was at 2 mm clot, okay, in my right side of the middle central artery.
Okay, so when you had this stroke, so where did you avail the services for it? Which hospital, in private or government?
As soon as my parents and my friends noticed the place dropping, they took me to neurology center, okay, nearby home. And my doctor, there the doctor asked us to go take me to city where my heart surgery has happened, okay, because the communication between the cardiologist and neurologist is completely will be much helpful for me, no, that's why they preferred my parents to take me to there.
Okay. So
from there, they took me to Chennai.
Okay.
Apollo Hospital.
Okay.
As soon as going to Chennai to the hospital, they took me to emergency room and.
Okay, so you were
operated. Stroke ward,
okay. And when did you? So before this issue, when this happened, were you aware of signs and symptoms of stroke or where to go?
No.
Okay.
I even don't know that there is a disease like this. Okay. Did not even heard about this. I usually thought the stroke is only the heart stroke.
Okay. And so, how long did you take for you to reach the hospital from your home to the hospital after you had stroke?
I was in 3 days in the critical care unit. Not unconscious. I was conscious. I was conscious only if my wife used to come. Okay. Otherwise, I was not. I was unconscious completely.
Okay. So your family took you to the hospital. You were there for around 3 days. And when did this process of rehabilitation start? After you recovered or during the hospital?
Actually, my process of rehabilitation started from the critical care unit itself, because all my BP and blood pressure and the cholesterol, sugar, all quite completely normal. And they are not the factors of my stroke also. And so they started the rehabilitation from the critical care unit itself. They gave me some passive movements in the critical care unit. And after shifting the ward, they took me to physiotherapy lab also.
Okay. So, did you have any kind of disability after the stroke?
No. I'm able to... I'm fighting much, okay? No disability. I felt like I would be disabled.
Okay. So,
what happened?
Okay. And so, which part of the body got affected? Any particular part which got affected?
See, actually, when brain is affected, the left side of the body gets paralyzed. My left hand and my left leg have been affected. Okay. I'm able to lift my. I'm showing you my the left hand affected hand. Okay.
Okay. When you undergone this kind of surgery and all, were you covered in any kind of insurance at that point of time, or what is everything was paid by your family? Did you have any kind of insurance to cover your hospitalization cost? No insurance.
I had, but those are not eligible for this kind of stroke.
Okay. Okay, so Arjun, I have seen your video of you working out on one of the treadmill and doing quite a fantastic job of it. So can you tell me when you started to now this amazing transformation? How was it when you started and now when you can you are such an inspiration for other stroke survivors? How did you do it? Your journey. I'm asking Arjun that how could you after your stroke to a situation where you can work out so nicely on a treadmill? How did that take place? Can you tell us that how you could get your movement in hand and legs? How much time it took for you to recover your leg?
Actually, first after the stroke, 2018 was very difficult for me to walk. I used to take my wife to have my wife's support and used to walk in the home also.
Okay. And so
2019 was my crucial recovery year. Okay.
Okay.
seen much improvement in that year, 18 to 19. And later 19 to 20 also I have. And year in the year from the year 19 to 20 I gained much confidence by riding Activa. Okay, my fingers and my hand become little free. And I have found some my what is it? मेरा हाथ को थोड़ा फ्रीनेस लग गया. I have experienced the freeness of my hand and arm. Also, I tried to write active also from the year to 2019 to 2020. Confidence mainly confidence helps the stroke recovery as per my.
So who what kind of exercises helped you?
Routine physiotherapy.
But how many hours of exercise do you do every day? Because I've seen you so active on the treadmill.
My physiotherapist used to give me two sessions, okay? Morning and evening. And later, after my physiotherapy session, I used to do another two times. My wife used to help me to perform all those things. Okay.
Okay. How many time each session?
1 hour.
So
only 4 hours or 24 hours.
Oh, so 4 hours. My God, that's excellent. I mean, I even can't do half of that if you ask me, and I'm not a stroke survivor. So you are quite an inspiration to all. So during this journey, were you ever depressed? You thought that you could never recover. Did you pass through that phase?
The depression will be the common issue for every stroke survivor. Okay.
Okay, and how did you overcome that? Because I've heard so many people saying that no, they cannot recover, they won't be able to do anything.
My friends and family, okay, gave me extraordinary support. I thank all of them. My friends, they used to take me outside, okay. Now I am going outside to pick someone, okay.
Okay. Right? Okay.
It's amazing. My record is amazing.
Okay. And so you were also one of a person who availed services from Dr. Vijay, I believe.
Yeah, yes.
So those rehabilitation set of exercises actually helped you out a lot, I believe. And do you still consult him for this?
Yes, of course.
Of course. So you are into this. So Vijay, are you employed or do you have your own business? What's your occupation at present?
Self-employed business.
Okay, you have your own business. So you are before you had a stroke, and from now you can have your own business and run it. There's no problem or issue with that.
No. My father and my brother are used to look after that business. Actually, it's our combined business.
Okay.
Me, so my father and my brother, younger brother, used to look after the shop, after the business, okay? And after the stroke, they used to look after them.
Okay. So another question, if you are able to answer that. See, the entire this rehabilitation, post your, I believe, surgery, what would have been the approximate cost involved in it?
What?
The cost, the money you have to pay for this rehabilitation services for which you have been undergoing?
Actually, per session, my physiotherapist used to charge 500 per session.
Okay. Like okay.
Per month, it used to cost 30,000, like, right? Two sessions per day. 500,000 rupees per day, and total 30 days per 30,000 per month, and 360,000 per year.
Okay, so is it quite a substantial
per year, like this 4 years? Okay, I'm still continuing.
Okay. So,
any more 14,80,000.
So quite.
And in
quite
between, I have admitted to rehabilitation center, which there they costed around 5,000 per day.
5,000
for a time of 2 months. 50,000 per day is 1,50,000 per month. Okay, and so 3 lakhs.
So it's
14,80,000, 17,80,000, and in the initial stage, in 2017, my Apollo hospital bill was 5 to 6 lakhs. There is nothing they have. They did not do any surgery and anything. Just only the charges of rent charges of control critical care unit and the stroke ward rental charges and the physiotherapy charges and the nursing charges were
okay.
For 6 lakhs.
Okay.
For only 6 days. Only 7 days. Okay, 1 week. 1 week per week. They used to charge 6 lakhs. I wondered.
Okay, and can you tell me why were you told that in between you were admitted in the rehab center in between, isn't it? So why were you admitted there?
Some of my friends used to do, actually my basic problem is after discharging also I used to smoke regularly. To break the habit of smoking, I myself preferred to join rehabilitation center.
Okay, so it was more anti-smoking thing in order to regain your health.
Like anything, okay. Anything which is going on continuous, if you break the chain, then it will change the lifestyle. Okay.
Okay.
I believe in it.
Okay. So
I prefer the rehabilitation center.
Okay. So
and thereby I achieved the quitting the smoking also.
Okay. Amazing. So. That's amazing because I have seen people trying but are unable to give up smoking. So you are a real achiever from a stroke survivor. You are more a stroke champion at this point of time. So
will become a champion soon. Okay.
Okay.
I will
only
update you.
Yeah. Yeah.
At the end of this year, I have separate my goal. Okay. Few things like full recovery. And to become your dad, okay?
So, any
other goals are for me.
Okay. So, Arjun, any other message for other stroke survivors who have joined this session? Any message you want to give it to them?
Don't give up. Keep working. It won't come. The moment you can gain, that much easily, okay? We keep on working. Change the therapies as much as you can, but not frequently. Take some time for each therapy takes at least a month, okay? For physiotherapy, a month. For acupuncture therapy, a month. And for your stimulation, 1 month. Like this. Actually, the stroke recovery is a journey. As Vijay has said, I say that it will be, sometimes it will be a lifetime journey. Of course, based on the problem, physicalness.
Okay. So, thanks a lot, Arjun, for giving us your time and joining for our session on webinar and inspiring other stroke survivors.
Sir, one more thing I would like to say for all the stroke survivors, care providers, please don't hesitate them, okay? And don't irritate them. Irritate the stroke survivors. Actually, yeah. Stroke survivors will be carrying many questions in their brain.
Yeah.
Many questions will be running out throughout the mind.
Okay. So, Arjun, if any other stroke survivor wants to reach out to you to ask about your journey, are you ready to share your experiences with them? And we will be directing any query they have regarding your recovery directly to you. Are you willing to share your story with them?
Yes.
Okay. So that is the amazing story of Arjun. He is a hero for all of us. And as another stroke survivor has said, Arjun, he wants you to write about your story and post it online. Maybe if you share your story, we'll be posting about it on our website, which we are launching soon. So anyone who wants to know more about Arjun and his journey should check out our website, join our Facebook page, and of course our WhatsApp group for Stroke Better Lives. So thank you all for joining us today. This is a series of webinar we are organizing for stroke survivors, their caregivers, and healthcare providers. This is the second such webinar. Do join us next Saturday with one stroke survivor and one neurologist based in Delhi. So till then, thank you all. Thank you for joining us. Any questions which you have, kindly address it to us by the link where you have joined. You must have seen our Facebook page and of course our WhatsApp group. Send your questions out there, and you can also send your questions by email. Thank you all for joining us today. Thank you, Arjun, again. And thank you, Dr. Vijay. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay. Thank you, Arjun. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you.